Macmillan Audio presents If You See Me, Don't Say Hi by Neel Patel. Read for you by the author.
Remember that you and I made this journey, that we went together to a place where there was nowhere left to go. Jhumpa Lahiri, the namesake. God of Destruction. The Wi-Fi was out. That was the first sign. The second was that my dress was an eyesore. Online, it had appeared chic and trendy. But in person, at the mall, it was an egregious mistake. Bachelorette party? The sales lady had asked. First date, I'd said. His name was Vibhash, and we'd met online through a dating website for Indians called shadi.com. He was an engineer. He was 35. He was handsome, with dark hair and dusky skin. The first time he messaged me, I told him all about my job as an interior designer, making it sound glamorous and important, even though it wasn't. It was depressing. Sometimes I would come home after staring at a blank wall for hours, wondering what to mount on it, and imagine my clients' lives unfolding without me. Once, during a renovation, I took the spare key of a doctor's beach house and drove there in the middle of the night. I walked around the large, empty space, which was sheeted with plastic, speckled with tape, and imagined myself living in it, with a husband, a dog, a child who looked vaguely like me. I stole a bottle of wine from their refrigerator and drank it in the front seat of my car. Then I backed into their mailbox. I wasn't always this way, but the friction of life has a way of turning sharp edges into smooth ones, smooth edges into sharp ones, until you've become a duller, slightly misshapen version of your former self. I used to be happy, in the way that people on Facebook seem happy, posting pictures of their husbands and friends. I was the kind of woman who would say things like, "I hope you get that promotion," or, "I'm sorry about your grandmother," and actually mean it. No one ever told me that happiness was like a currency, that when it goes, it goes, and that few people are willing to give you some of theirs. The cable guy showed up at 7:45. It was dark outside, black clouds hovering low to the ground. He looked Latin or Persian with a thick, scruffy beard. I stared at the tattoo on his arm, a skeleton of a mermaid surrounded by a school of dead fish, then up at his face. "The Wi-Fi is out," I said, closing the door behind us. He followed me into the living room, where my modem sat next to a pile of indiscriminate wires. He looked me up and down. "Are you going to a party?" "Excuse me?" "The dress," he said, smiling. "It looks like you're about to hit the town." I went upstairs and examined myself in the mirror. Earlier that evening, Vibhash had asked me to send him more pictures, so I did. Me on a sailboat, me on the beach, me looking sad, then happy, then cross, all in a little frame I'd put up on Instagram. He didn't respond, and I thought I would die. Then, just as I was about to delete him from my cell phone, my email, my life, he said I was beautiful, and it was funny how it could happen. How just like that, you could live again. I went back down and found the cable guy standing in a pile of thick cords and wires and plastic tubing. His tool belt was on the floor. His name was stitched across his chest in bright blue lettering, Ricky A. I wondered what the A was short for. Alvarez? Alvarado? I was famished. "Are you almost done?" "What?" "Oh, yeah. I just gotta clip this wire here and..." I went back into the kitchen and poured myself a glass of wine. I thought about Vibhash, about his thick, dark hair that was graying at the sides, his wire-framed glasses, his black Mercedes Benz. He was 6'2", tall for an Indian, with a fine build and ropey muscles. His profile included a picture of him running a marathon and the way the sweat had poured down his front, darkening his shorts, had made my thighs turn to water. I was thinking about this when I felt Ricky A's presence behind me. He was standing in the half-light, staring at a picture of Lord Shiva on the windowsill. His blue face stared back at us, serenely. "Are you Hindu?" "What?" "This picture. It's a Hindu god, right? Are you?" "No," I said. "I mean, yes, maybe. I guess so. My mother put that there." "My cousin is a Hindu. He converted. He lives in Orange County with a bunch of guys in an ashram." "Are you close?"
"Excuse me?"
"You and your mom. Are you too close?" It was a personal question to ask, practically vulgar, and yet I found myself answering. "I don't know. We used to be, back when I was engaged. Then my fiancé canceled the wedding, and now she looks at me like I'm an alien." I wondered if he, too, would look at me differently. We stood like that for a while, Ricky and I, gazing at the picture of Lord Shiva, trying to decipher what lay behind his enigmatic smile, when my cell phone broke the silence. It was Vibhash. He was waiting. "Look, is it fixed or not?" I asked. "Oh, sure. Why don't you check it out for yourself?" Ricky A followed me into the living room. I opened my laptop. I could feel his eyes on the back of my head. I could smell his cologne, too. A cheap-smelling fragrance that reminded me of the boys I went to high school with. I was nervous. I covered up the screen with my hand, embarrassed by the Match.com profile that suddenly popped up in the window. "Yep, it works."
"Are you sure?"
"Yes, I'm sure," I said. "Look, I really have to go now." He followed me to the door. He scribbled something onto a receipt. Then he handed it over. "This is my cell," he said. "If it acts up again, you just call me." He stared at me for a moment, as if he were about to say something more. Then he stepped out into the night. "Have fun at your party." 2 years ago, I had it all. A successful career, a doting fiancé, and an army of well-wishers. I didn't realize the former two determined the latter. After Ummel broke up with me, my friends dropped off like flies, making excuses for their absences. Emergencies and scheduling conflicts and some horrific but convenient catastrophes. Thank God for Valerie. We went from drunken sorority girls to drunken adults, functioning through our alcoholism. Then one day she got a boyfriend, Doug, and everything changed. Once, we were having brunch together when I asked Valerie if she ever wondered if Doug was gay.
"Excuse me?"
"You know," I smiled. "The mannerisms."
"What mannerisms?"
She dropped her croissant on the table. "Well, the way he moves, for one, and the way he talks, and his voice. It's kind of nasally, right?" I laughed, doing an impersonation. She stared at me. "I don't know what you mean." I was only joking about him being gay. I only sort of thought he was gay. I wouldn't have said anything at all if Valerie hadn't been going on about the engagement ring they'd seen at Tiffany, and how it was perfect, and how Doug had wanted a destination wedding because that way fewer people would attend. I just wanted to inject a little humor back into our lives, the way we did when we were girls, when life and all its disappointments were a million miles away from us. She said it was best if we didn't speak to each other for a while. My Uber driver, Siddharth was his name, was lost,
I am following directions, and round we are going. It was dark out, stars glimmering across the sky like handfuls of spilled salt. I was an hour late. "Listen," I said, "how long is this going to take? We were supposed to be there 10 minutes ago." He glanced at his wristwatch. "Jesus Christ," I said, "I might as well have driven myself." For weeks, while Vibhash and I messaged each other, I had dreamt of this moment. At the office, the gym, while listening to music in the shower. My previous experiences with dating had been disappointments, awkward dinners with stilted conversation. But Vibhash was showing signs of promise. We already shared all the things in common two people could possibly share: a love of foreign films, hip-hop music, and Japanese food. We'd already had the requisite conversations, in which we divulged every embarrassing story from our youth. We'd already told each other about the romantic failures we'd had, the mistakes we'd made, and, at 34, I had already begun to imagine myself as a bride again, wearing the gold and ruby jewelry my mother had brought back from India, shortly before Umal and I split up. It was pathetic. It was also premature. I made it to the bar and scanned the crowd of well-dressed men and women drinking Chardonnay in their various shades of black. But Vibhash wasn't there. He wasn't in the bathroom either, and, after waiting for 20 minutes, my foolish hope began to deflate, like a voluminous hairstyle that fell flat on my head. Then a strange man looked at me from across the bar, smiling. "Are you looking for someone?" "Yes," I said, "I am." He pulled out a napkin. "Are you Anita Gundapaneni?" I said. "Yes, that's me." He handed me the napkin. "He left this for you." I stared at it until the words blurred and split in two, then snapped back into focus. "Sorry, didn't see you. Had to leave." My heart sank. I sent him a text message, "Hey, come back," and waited for him by the bar. He never showed up. He didn't respond to my text either, and, after waiting for 30 minutes, I decided to give up, ordering another Uber home. I was relieved when the driver turned out to be a young white woman with colored streaks in her hair. She drove a Mazda, and she was listening to a song from my past, "Where Do You Go" by No Mercy. Valerie and I used to dance to it in her room. "Where do you go, my lovely? I want to know." I thought about calling Valerie and playing the song for her over the phone, but then I pictured her at home with Doug, watching Netflix, some contrived film she would later rave about over yoga or brunch, or at a dinner party I wasn't invited to. And I fell asleep. "Miss, we're here." We were sitting outside my house. It was pitch black. I let myself in, dropping my keys on the console and slipping off my heels. I poured myself a glass of wine. I didn't need it, but I was thirsty. All night, I had been poised for it to happen, the transition, the moment my life would change forever. And now it hadn't, and everything was the same. I walked over to my laptop and went on match.com, scrolling through my messages. Then I remembered that it was Umal's birthday. I'd seen it on Facebook earlier. I thought about calling him. It was a habit of ours, when we were dating, to be the first ones to greet each other on our birthdays, whenever we were apart. I saw my cell phone sitting on the countertop next to my handbag, and when I made my way toward it, I tripped over something on the floor. I stared at it. It was a tool belt. I knelt down and examined it in my hands. It was made of dark leather and it smelled faintly of Old Spice. But I couldn't remember where it had come from, or how it had ended up on my living room floor. And then, just like that, I did. I went into the kitchen and grabbed my bag, searching for his number. I emptied the contents, chapstick, eye cream, a firming lotion from Macy's, two lipsticks in the shades of coral and mauve.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.